Now, it's fascinating to me that in the scripture, the Antichrist, this coming world leader, is associated with a peace treaty. A peace treaty that he will be involved with the nation of Israel, a 7-year agreement, and surprise, surprise, the treaty will be broken halfway through, and the Bible is very specific about all that. And of course, 7 years is the exact time frame of the tribulation period itself. Paul says, sudden destruction will come upon them when they're saying peace, safety. Oh, it's great. And then, like a woman going into labor, and it's a beautiful illustration because, ladies, as you know, once you go into labor, it may take a while, but there's no turning back. Once you're really in labor, and, you know, think about it from a first century perspective as well, going into labor wasn't necessarily the same joyful occasion as it is today. You get on the phone, we're in labor, we're going to the hospital, right? Because a lot of times the mother didn't make it, or the child didn't make it, or both. Giving birth was very challenging and difficult in those days. So there's a more powerful sentiment behind the illustration, I think. But there will be no escape, he says. Now, again, the contrast. See? It's going to happen to them. But you, brethren, you see, I believe that God intends and has intended for Christians of whatever century, whatever time frame, to live with the expectancy of the Lord Jesus Christ's return at any moment. The imminency of the Lord's return. I believe that God intends that. I believe he intended it for the Thessalonians there and has intended it throughout history. Another reason why the rapture happening before the tribulation makes sense, because if we are awaiting the Lord's return at any moment, nothing else has to happen to take place. But if he doesn't come, if we're not going to have the rapture until after the tribulation or halfway through or whatever, well, then we got to wait for the temple to be rebuilt. We got to wait for Antichrist to show up. We got a lot of stuff that we can just look for, and it hadn't happened today, so, well, the Lord can't come back today. But of course, we don't have to wait for those things. God doesn't tell us in his word to look for the Antichrist. A lot of Christians have done that over the years. For example, a lot of Christians in America thought Napoleon was the Antichrist. And so much so that it influenced discussions on whether or not the young new nation of the United States should go to war with Britain in the War of 1812, which was a necessary war. But the idea is, look, the Brits are Christians too, and yeah, we have our differences, but, you know, the Brits are over there in France fighting Napoleon, the Antichrist, so maybe we shouldn't, you know, go to war with the Britons, because, you see, and so it was that much of a influence on people's decision. But we're not told to look for the Antichrist. We're told to look for Jesus Christ in Scripture. And so, given the fact that we are sons of light, sons of the day, we're not of the night, what should be the concern of the believer in the last days? And Paul addresses that in verse 6. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet, the hope of salvation. Now, you know, when you read in the New Testament the command to be sober as a Christian, it is far more than just simply abstaining from drunkenness. We saw this in 1 Peter. Peter said, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober. And he said, don't fashion yourselves in your former lusts, like in your ignorance, before you were a believer in Jesus Christ, but live a holy life, be holy. The word says God is holy, so you be holy. And so being sober involves much more than alcohol. And once again, we have, as we see in Scripture in several places, the idea of putting on this armor. It's a little different from Ephesians 6, but still, putting on a breastplate, putting on a helmet, those are defensive pieces of armor as we live in difficult times. And it's not a direct comparison to what you read about in Ephesians 6, you know, breastplate of righteousness and all. But instead, you have those Christian triplets, as it were, the faith, the love, the hope. That should be the mark of the believer's life. Those three characteristics should be a part of your life: faith, love, and hope. So Paul's basically saying, act like who you are. You are a child of light, of the day. So don't act like those who live in the night, who are children of the night. He's drawing that parallel there. Now, there's nothing wrong, of course, with sleeping. He says those who sleep, sleep in the night. That's where sleeping takes place. But, of course, he's using this figurative language. You don't want to sleep. You want to have your eyes open. You want to be awake. You want to be vigilant in the times in which you live. And those who are drunk in the night. Remember, we're talking about a culture where drunkenness was not seen as a sin outside of the church. I mean, the pagans got drunk all the time. But you want to make sure you got loaded after sundown. I mean, you didn't get drunk at noon. Society would frown on you for doing that. There were things you should be doing. You should be working, just like you wouldn't be sleeping at noon. What are you, some lazy bum? No, but it's perfectly fine to party and sleep throughout the night. That's who you are. And the contrast is there. Be the type of person that you are, Christian. Live like a child of the light. Be vigilant and be committed to a holy life. And when he mentions putting on the helmet, the hope of salvation, he now explains that particular thing. The hope of salvation. What does that mean? Well, we see the calling of the believer in verse 9. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, and here, of course, sleep is being used as it was in chapter 4, talking about death. So whether we're alive or whether we die, we should live together with Him. Now, if someone asks me, well, Steve, why is it specifically that you believe the rapture will take place before this tribulation period? My primary reason for believing that goes back to the prophecy in Daniel 9 of the 70 weeks. 70 seven-year periods of time, 490 years, that are determined upon Israel. Upon Israel. And if you read that chapter, it's very specific that 483 of those years are going to take place from the time to rebuild the city of Jerusalem, which when the prophecy came to Daniel was lying in rubble, from that command, rebuild the streets, the wall, Jerusalem, until the coming of the Messiah, 483 years, and to the day it was fulfilled, as scholars have proved by getting into the calendar and showing how to the day, and what is that day? It's the day that Jesus rode in to Jerusalem on that donkey, what we call Palm Sunday. The one day when he allowed himself to be hailed as the King of Israel. The day, not only did he allow it, he arranged for it. He organized it. He says, this is the day. The rocks would cry out if the people weren't crying out. But that leaves 7 years. 490 years are determined on Israel. Where do the other seven go? Well, Daniel's very clear. The other 7 years involve, like I said, this peace treaty and this coming rule leader that we call the Antichrist and all.